Well, hello everyone, and welcome to this special episode of DL Weekly. This time we are talking with some community members and Star Wars fanatics that are constantly chatting in our chat about Star Wars. Today we're going to talk about all of the new stuff coming to the Star Wars universe that was announced at the Investors Day that happened at the beginning of December. So this is going to be a wonderful chat for all of you Star Wars fans. Again, just a quick recap. Earlier this month, Disney announced 11 Star Wars film and TV productions that are at various points of production. Many will land on Disney Plus exclusively, so if you don't have a subscription there, I would highly recommend going and getting a subscription, at least before all these things start coming out. It's just me this week, no Tricia, so we've got some other people that are going to be here, like I said. First of all, of course, we have producer James who's here, and of course, anybody who's listening to the podcast knows that producer James is a huge Star Wars fan. I don't want to sell this short. I want to let you guys know also that we will have a discussion topic at some point that will be producer James and producer Vern and maybe a couple other people talking about Star Wars related to the parks. This is just going to be this particular aspect of Star Wars. So welcome to our roundtable, producer James.
Thanks. Excited to be here.
So next up, we have Erik from Concierge, also the voice of DL Weekly. If you've listened to the podcast at all and listened to the intro, you know Erik's voice, at least. He is also the co-host of the Supreme Resort podcast, which pits basically the same kind of thing from Disney World to Disneyland. So if you would like to hear a lively discussion about comparing two similar things between the two different resorts, that's the place for you. Welcome, Erik.
Lively is correct. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Weekly tier and community trivia master Liberty is also joining us, and her partner Shane, who is the Star Wars expert between them. But I will say, Liberty, you've done a really great job doing trivia and stuff. So I know you have at least some Star Wars knowledge.
Thank you for having me. Excited to be here.
Thank you.
Yeah, Shane, this is Shane's first time actually being really an integral part of the community. So this is, I'm really excited to have his knowledge and find out his point of view on some things. Of course, we have Tricia, who is the most enthusiastic and Star Wars supporter and Jedi Master and mother to Biddy, her version of Baby Yoda. Welcome to the show, Tricia.
May the Force be with you.
Oh, perfect. Finally, we have community manager and Star Wars fan Freya also joining us. And Freya, I want to make sure that anybody listening to this knows between you and Kate and, of course, Liberty as well, because Liberty is our trivia master. And, of course, a bunch of other people in the community. You guys do a great job keeping the Discord chat lively and moderated and all that good stuff. So thank you so much. And thank you for being part of this today.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. May the Force be with you.
I also want to take this moment to point out that we are hosting a Star Wars Wednesdays, which will be Return of the Jedi on Wednesday, January 13th at 6 p.m. Pacific. If you are a supporter, you can go to dlweekly.net/support. If you are not a supporter, to become one and get in the Discord chat, and we will have this lovely Star Wars Wednesday night on the 13th of January. So now let's get into what everybody is here to listen to. We're doing this as a round table, which is something that we have not done before. Everybody joining us is a patron of some sort. So if you want to support the podcast, you might be able to be on a round table like this in the future if you guys like it. If you do like it, let us know. Send us an email at feedback@dlweekly.net. If you have any suggestions on other roundtables you'd like to see or be part of, please let us know. So Disney announced, the announcement included 9 shows and 2 films somewhere in the works. So we'll start with the films and work our way through the shows afterwards. So up first is Rogue Squadron. Director Patty Jenkins, known for Wonder Woman, which is coming out on Christmas, or came out on Christmas, and we saw on Christmas, which is amazing to be back in the theaters again, is at the helm of this one. So the film is guaranteed to showcase dogfights and space battles galore. It's scheduled to release Christmas of 2023. So we'll start with you, James. What do you think of this one?
Oh, I think it's great. Like, I remember playing the Rogue Squadron video games, which are grossly unrelated to this film. And I think that the space battles are one thing that was really captured really well in like Rogue One. And so if they can really build off of that and tell the stories of the new people, I think it's something that'll be well done.
Liberty.
I'm really excited to see them introduce a new generation of starfighter pilots, and just really excited for the character development of these new pilots that we're going to be introduced to, see what boundaries they push. And I think it's going to be an amazing like thrill to see.
Shane.
Yeah, I think it's a great opportunity for them to tap into like a very popular genre of movies that's different from the rest of the Star Wars canon, and just like a more maybe traditional wartime movie, in a sense. It's a lot more gritty and not as big stakes as Save the World, but just like maybe battles here and there. And the day-to-day fighter pilot.
That kind of sounds, you know, like what they've done with The Mandalorian, right? Where it's something that's kind of not everybody's going to go save the whole galaxy, but it's just this kind of like smaller storyline. James, can you remind me too, before we continue on, do we know when this is taking place in the Star Wars universe?
I don't know if they give us a timeline. I know in her announcement, Kathleen Kennedy said it'll move us into a future era in the galaxy. So I think it's post-sequel. Someone else back me up on this.
This is Erik. I saw the same thing, James, and that's what got me thinking, because Rogue One was so amazing, and the space battles had me gripping the arms of my chair in the theater. I was so excited to see new ships and the old footage spliced in, and it was great. And I thought, well, obviously Rogue Squadron can't be a true sequel of Rogue One with the same characters, but maybe we continue the story. But then seeing this move the saga into the future era of the galaxy, I'm sure the legendary Rogue Squadron persists after the new sequel trilogy is done. I'm really excited to see where it goes from here.
Tricia?
Yeah, I'm excited too, because the 90s video game spawned a series, I think it was 10 books, about X-Wing pilots that were part of this. And I'd love to see Wedge come back. Yes. I think it was the Chuck Wendig Aftermath series where it was mentioned that he was a teacher of new pilot recruits. No. So I'd love to see him maybe come back as a role as a teacher to these new pilots.
Who doesn't want to see more Wedge? I mean, he's one of the most iconic minor characters, I guess, in the Star Wars universe. He doesn't get, you know, the billing of any of the, you know, other characters. So that would be great. Freya?
I am excited. I'm not usually excited for like pilots and space battles as much as I am about all of the Force stuff and the Jedi stuff. That's usually what I go in for more. I like that more, but I'm really excited because it's Patty Jenkins. And I think that's exciting. And we just had the new Rogue Squadron game come out. It seems like they found something that we really like, that the Star Wars fandom really likes. So I'm glad that they're leaning into that.
I was going to say, I agree with what Frey is bringing up about Patty Jenkins, because like I think a lot about the struggles the DC universe had to build itself up. Mm-hmm. But Wonder Woman is one of those shining spots out of it. Like, people really appreciated and wanted that sequel. And so I think that's a lot of the Patty Jenkins touch on this, making it happen.
Really, really want to watch it just because of that. And because of Rogue One actually has made me like the idea more of just going away from pure Force users and only having Force users. Rogue One kind of got me into that. And then Mando has gotten me into that, even though we still have Baby Yoda, but I'm excited.
A couple things. One, I want to say, it sounds like all of you guys are excited to see a different, like a classic genre, almost like with The Mandalorian did kind of like the Western genre, where this is more like a military fighter pilot kind of genre thing that could be from this. Also bringing in things potentially like Wedge and stuff, where you could, you know, you bring in those characters like The Mandalorian has done. And I'm going to mention The Mandalorian a lot because I feel like it is obviously the most recent. And I think that is kind of the way Disney is going to have it kind of go in the future, because they've seen the success of it. So is there anything that you want from this show that you think or from this movie that you're really looking forward to, or something that you hope that they put into it? Or is there anything that you don't want in it that you're hoping they don't do?
Yeah, for me, I have a feeling they're going to reference Luke, at least being that squadron and the fighting. But like, I think one thing that Mando has done a relatively good job until this season was like making it its own story and not relying on certain big characters to, you know, like for big moments of chivalry. So I think it's a good opportunity for them to finally like totally create a new entity that removes from the traditional Skywalker in any sense.
I'm going to play off of Trisha's comment before about Wedge. We got just a glimpse of Wedge knowing that he's still alive in Rise of Skywalker. I'm sure we can assume he made it through that battle alive and unscathed. And if he's still teaching the next generation, I'm all for it.
I'd like to see what they do if this is really taking place in the future. We don't have the Sith anymore. So what is the antagonist now?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I feel like something I didn't think about, and again, I'm going back to The Mandalorian. One of the things I didn't think about was The Mandalorian takes place after Return of the Jedi. I didn't think about the fact that there's still remnants of the Empire. Just because the Death Star 2 got blown up doesn't mean that the Empire is just gone, you know? So it's interesting to see that there's still a lot of the Empire out and about and around. I currently am reading the first in the trilogy of the Thrawn books, which is really good. I like Thrawn as a character, which, again, I know we're not talking about that, but Mandalorian mentioned Thrawn. I'm very, very excited because I want to see a live action version of him. I would watch an entire show about Thrawn because I feel like there is so much you can do with him. And for once, one thing I kind of like sometimes is when they take somebody who could be a villain. Thrawn could be a villain because he's part of the Empire, which, so we've framed that the Empire is the villains. But you could frame Thrawn not as a villain. You could appreciate that he's a great
strategist.
Strategist, thank you. He's a great strategist, and he's really good at outthinking things and looking at a problem in totally different ways. So the fact that you could take someone who, again, would maybe be thought of as a villain or on the bad side of things and appreciate the fact that those people have skill and value, because the Empire has kind of been in Star Wars shown as being sometimes incompetent and not very good and stupid. I mean, we make jokes about stormtroopers not being able to hit the broadside of a barn door, you know, all that stuff. So it'll be nice to see like the Empire actually, the reason that they are the Empire, like obviously they have to be successful at some point.
Yeah. And I think another cool thing about Thrawn is that like he was in Star Wars Legends, right? He was in the Legends canon. And so he's so popular that he was actually brought over and keeps getting brought over into current media. So I think that's really cool.
I wonder how much you mentioning Thrawn makes me think back to Trisha's point. I feel like this is going to be the running story of this roundtable is back to Trisha's point. But you know, Thrawn comes from a group outside of like the explored galaxy that we're familiar with in Star Wars. So I think the opportunity for who's the villain is how far can we keep expanding the galaxy? Like, do we get to see someone like the Chiss Ascendancy or something else?
I mean, there's so much in, you know, the Star Wars universe is what that is. It's a universe. So there's so many stories you could tell, and we can get beyond, and I think we'll talk about this a little bit later, but we can get beyond the Skywalker era, you know, the Battle of Yavin era, that kind of 30 years plus minus, you know, there's so much more that we can talk about. I mean, the Jedi have been around for millennia. So like there's all those stories. There's the future. I mean, there's all this, you know, it's just like reality, right? Just like the universe is a large place. We can cover all types of stuff, which is why probably they're coming out with nine shows and two films.
I just wish they also announced like a Revenge of the Chiss movie. That would be so cool.
The other film mentioned is an untitled production from cult favorite director Taika Waititi. If the name isn't familiar, Waititi played IG-11 in The Mandalorian and directed the final episode of its first season. He says the script is complete and is scouting locations for filming. Speculation is release in 2025. So, Tricia, we'll start with you since everybody's going to keep coming back to your comments about things. We'll just start with you. What do you think about this?
Well, I think Taika did a really nice job on The Mandalorian and kind of showed that he's capable of fitting within what Star Wars fans want. My only concern is that we've had so many things fall to the wayside. You know, they talked about like Kevin Feige coming in from Marvel, and they talked about Rian Johnson having a trilogy, you know, and Benioff and Weiss was supposed to do, you know, something with Star Wars before they went to Netflix. And so this just being so far removed from where we are currently and like no information, I'm just concerned that it won't actually come to fruition. But I would love it to, because I think his directing style is incredible.
Erik?
Yeah, I was pretty worried about that one, too. We've had so many different projects kind of come and go, and they announce all these great series that sound amazing. What happened to all those movies they talked about? I did see just a couple days ago that Taika tweeted out an apology as a response to all of the shows, saying that he apologizes for how he's going to ruin Star Wars for everybody.
Oh, no.
Now, knowing him, that's probably a joke, and a lot of people took it pretty badly, but I like his humor. I like the way he has learned to, you know, he went from this indie weird comedy sort of director into this guy who is capable of directing a Thor movie for Marvel. And I mean, say what you will, personally, Thor Thor Ragnarok was my favorite of the Thor movies. It changed his character a lot, but I really liked what he did with such an iconic character. And that entire movie, I think I've watched that movie more than most of the others in the Marvel canon. So I'm looking forward to what he can do with Star Wars.
You know, I've heard that from a lot of people, Erik, that Thor Ragnarok was amazing. I personally have not seen it. I need to do much better with the Marvel Cinematic Universe. It is on my list of things I definitely want to see. Liberty.
I would agree with both Erik and Tricia. I think this is the first, obviously, I'm hearing of this as of like a few days ago. I didn't hear too much. And I'm a huge fan of the screenplay for Jojo Rabbit. I'm a fan of Taika. I think it is funny that he recently tweeted like, what, when he had heard about the new Star Wars feature. I think we'll just have to wait and see how he kind of handles this new feature film. I definitely am a fan of how he directed a few of the Mandalorian episodes. And I think that his focus on also like the character development, but also very key action scenes has been really significant in his like films and the episodes. So I'm excited to see where they go with this. But I think a little bit more information as it unfolds would be great.
Freya. Yeah.
I am super, super excited. I think this is the movie that I'm the most excited for, just because I love Taika Waititi ever since I saw What We Do in the Shadows, because I love his mix of comedy and also just his mix of comedy and drama. And then we see that from like when he directed Hunt for the Wilder People, which is also really, really good. So, and then you see his expansion of his ability to do drama and comedy in Thor Ragnarok. So I'm super excited for what he's going to be bringing to the Star Wars universe.
Shane.
Echoing off what everyone else has said, with not much information, I can say that I'm excited for it. I think he has a very proven track record, even all back to his indie days. And as mentioned with Thor Ragnarok, that was pretty, they took a, to my opinion, pretty like vanilla, boring franchise and like finally like made that character exciting with that movie. I was actually, Liberty recently watched all the Marvel movies this year. We marathoned them. Mm-hmm. And that's the first one she watched early. And she's like, I love this movie. Like I wasn't even home that day. And she's like, I absolutely love this movie. And I think that he, I think no matter what, he has a proven track record. He hasn't missed yet. Going to be a hit, whatever he does. I think that since he's already involved in the Mandalorian series, or has been, and he's already kind of inside, they're going to give him a little bit more free reign. And I'm excited to see what happens. I think this is a good opportunity that his humor will come into the Star Wars universe. Because Star Wars has always like had that kind of childish, like a little jokes here and there, but I think this is the first time where it can actually be like legit funny.
I agree with you. I really like the humor that kind of gets spread out through Star Wars. In the first season of Mandalorian, I love the fact that there was that scene with the two stormtroopers and they had that kind of like slapstick comedy thing because the baby Yoda was in the pouch or whatever. He's like, I just want to look at it. and then there was just sight gag things, like they were trying to shoot, you know, he was trying to target practice and it was really far off, you know, which plays to the joke about the stormtroopers. One thing I want to mention before we get away from movies, because I think this is a great topic to talk about and we kind of touched on it between everybody, is what do we think about the directors that people, you know, that the different directors have made the different movies and fans' response to different directors doing different things with Star Wars. Like the one that I think comes to mind the most obvious is when they did episode 8 and it seemed like it went in a totally different direction, but the fans were just very upset about this. So Liberty, I see you shaking your head. So what do you think about that?
I want to marinate on that a little more.
Okay.
You want to punt it? You can punt it to someone else. Yeah.
James, go ahead.
Well, I think that was one of your biggest problems. Is like it just felt like a story arc that didn't mix together. Like we had an idea for a story, and then it deviated, and then we tried to go back to it, and it just gets really confusing. That's why I feel like there's so much justified outrage about Rise of Skywalker, because I feel like it punted on Episode 8. Like it just made so much of what happened irrelevant. And like what I'm learning more and more is how fickle us Star Wars fans are. Like Episode 8 was so different from what we've had before. And I think that's why we struggle with that one too.
I always think back to a comment that I saw online, and I think it's so true. nobody hates Star Wars more than Star Wars fans. Because it seems like anytime they try to do anything, you know, so you get the people, because it's such a wide fan base, I think is the reason. And because there's so many fans of it, I think you'll have people that like the fact that they're trying something new, but then you'll have a group of people that don't like that. They just want the same kind of thing over and over. So people were very excited with The Force Awakens. People generally liked that movie, but then they thought, it was basically A New Hope again. So you had those people that were kind of upset about it. So then they tried to do something different what is the second?
The
Last Jedi. Thank you. I couldn't think of what the name of the movie was. So The Last Jedi went in a totally different thing. And for me personally, I just felt sad the whole time I watched the movie because everything just felt hopeless. Because the whole storyline with that, they're just running away and their ships just keep getting blown up. And I just felt like we've lost, this whole movie is just watching the good guys, you know, in the air quotes, just get obliterated until the end or whatever. And I just felt like after the first time I watched it, I thought, I just feel sad and bummed after that movie. But then the second time I saw it, I liked it a lot better. But I did enjoy that they tried to do something different with it, which is good. So, Tricia, what do you have to say about different directors and response and trying to do things differently? Do you like that? Do you not like that?
I think for the last trilogy, it didn't work so well because you were trying to tell a continuous story. But with so many projects, I think it'll be better. The other thing, too, is you're bringing in people. And when we get to Lando and we talk more about that, that's another director where they're passionate. And I think that's the thing, is passionate about Star Wars. Or in the case of Rogue Squadron, Patty Jenkins had that video and her father was a pilot. And I think, like, even if it's not specifically Star Wars, it's the subject matter. Like, I think they're finally hitting their stride and they're finding the passionate people who can tell a really good story that just happens to be Star Wars related as well.
Yeah. I mean, I know that Star Wars fans are different than Star Trek fans, and there's like a weird rivalry there. But one thing that I like about Star Wars or Star Trek is that it takes stories that we can all relate to, and it just happens to be in sci-fi. And I think that that's what Star Wars is kind of doing right now. And I think it's doing a really great job at it and taking characters. I mean, again, Mandalorian, you've seen such a progression of his character over two seasons of, you know, at first, you know, he just kind of didn't care and was just doing the job and whatever. And then, you know, his character has, especially with this, you know, season finale that just happened, you know, his character has really grown so much in two seasons. So what do you think, Shane?
In order to do this successfully, we've seen examples in The Mandalorian. We've seen examples in the whole entire Marvel universe with Kevin Feige. It's like, you need to have a really strong showrunner. I don't think Kathleen Kennedy probably did that great of a job with the new trilogy in terms of things like they just hired, like, okay, we're coming back. We need a big director. Boom, got one. All right, people like this movie. Second movie, another big director. Boom. Oh, they don't like this one as much. Bring back another big director that they like and try to save it. And so I don't think, like, they need to have a strong, like, person leading it that oversees the entire thing and knows where it's going to go at each point. And helps these directors bring it to life and not so just like turn over the keys and be like, all right, create us something.
Do you think that's where they're going with Dave Filoni and John Favreau? Like, they seem to be doing really well, yeah, kind of leading that.
Yeah, I believe that because like I'm not sure if literally every episode, but it seems like I think John Favreau writes every episode. So at least the story is consistent. And then he turns it to the directors to kind of put their own like style on each episode that blends together depending on like the story points. But yeah, between him and then this big Marvel example, which I think is probably the greatest example, just the how many movies it has, like you need that one person that's truly in charge.
Freya?
Yeah, I feel like they just jumped in to the sequel trilogy without really having an idea of where they were going. And that's the biggest problem. I really liked The Force Awakens and I really loved The Last Jedi. And I don't really like The Rise of Skywalker just because it's a reaction to the reaction to The Last Jedi.
Yeah.
As opposed to being its own film that wanted to tell its own story. It was trying to correct things that were perceived to be wrong. But I am excited for the future. And I think Kathleen Kennedy is doing a better job of delegating things because she does seem to have had some issues with getting and keeping directors and being on the same page with the directors. But I think that they have learned their lesson now and that they're focusing a lot more on making sure that things are solid before they're announced and making sure that the directors and the showrunners and everybody who's producing in the background are on the same page. And I think that that's probably why we're going to have a lot smoother TV shows and smoother Star Wars stuff going forward. I hope so anyway.
Me too. Erik?
Not a whole lot I have to say on top of what everybody else has said. I agree with a lot of this. The main problem, and I still like all three of the new movies, but you do get a sense that they tried to go in a bold direction and then they chickened out. And that happened. It happened in a lot of ways throughout that whole period. And they wanted to come out with these spinoff movies and they did great with Rogue One. And then they chickened out on Solo. They changed directors halfway through because they didn't like what was happening. It seems like they're really laying it on the line with all of these new series and movies and this huge of an announcement. So let's hope that means they're ready to go all in on it and have that larger creative vision.
So now we're going to transition from the movies to the television shows that are coming out. And a question, kind of judging off what you just said, Erik, is before we get into the shows, is do we feel a TV series is a better place to tell a Star Wars story? Do we like the idea that a story can kind of have that room to breathe and build and kind of create its own like little universe? Or do we like the movie, you get a, 2.5-3 hours here, 2.5-3 hours here, and you get that every couple of years? Or do we like the mixture where you can still tell these huge stories, the movies, and then you can tell like longer, more sustained stories? We'll start with you, Erik, on that one, since we were just talking about it.
Sure. I think the one of the things that the most recent trilogy suffered from was the massive amount of buildup. Last Jedi was over, we started talking about what the last movie would be about. The second Force Awakens was done, we're talking about who is Rey, what is her lineage, who could she be? And that never seems to go well for Star Wars fans because we spend too long fantasizing about what we want. And then when we get what they give us, we say, well, I didn't want that story. I wanted that other story that I imagined. And that never goes well. And I think maybe Mandalorian has ruined things now because we've had two amazing seasons. But at least we've had episodes in both seasons where we said that wasn't the most exciting thing ever. We breathed a little bit. We added on to the character. We can accept that from a TV show. We know that when you look at something as huge as Clone Wars, there were multiple story arcs where you said, well, on rewatch, I'm going to skip that one because that didn't add a ton and I don't, need to spend that time the next time around. And hopefully that feeling continues when we start up with these new TV series.
Freya.
I think that they work well as both movies and as TV shows. I like the idea that a movie can provide like an anchor and then the TV shows can sort of fan out around it. I think that you can tell good stories in movies for Star Wars, but I think that we need to stop thinking of movies as like, this is where you tell the big Star Wars stories and the TV shows is where you tell the smaller Star Wars stories. I think that you'd be just as good telling a small Star Wars story on the big screen. And I hope that they do consider doing that, not just telling the big overarching stories, but tell smaller stories. Because I think The Mandalorian would work just as well as a movie as it does as a TV show. It's just a matter of how you write it and how you make it.
Shane?
I think that as seen in The Mandalorian and those other TV shows in general that we love, I think giving it the room to breathe and develop character development has been really like beneficial to storytelling. And then also not leaving characters behind, like Finn, for example, like had a big like seven have a big role and then kind of drops off. And I think that's just what you have in movies. Like something's got to go eventually because it's time crunch. And yeah, I just think that with TV, you have the time to tell the story, time to focus on certain characters, give them the like, an episode per character, or elaborate on plot points, make them longer. And the beautiful thing about TV is especially like if you weren't a fan of an episode, it's like, okay, I didn't really enjoy that one, but I got next week. Whereas with a movie, if you bomb a movie and people don't like it, like that was it for quite a while. And then I think my last point would be with the movies, especially in the Star Wars universe, I think what has been proven, like even the original trilogy or even the prequel trilogy, they can't just rely on a movie. They have to have supplemental content. So whether it's comics or books or cartoons or video games, like people are like, oh, I love this character, but he had a very minor role. And then you might find out about more about that character in a comic book or a novel. So I think they didn't have a chance to do that with the new trilogy because they're so worried about the kid pumping out as much new content as possible. So I think that's a lesson learned that the original trilogy was able to lean into is just keep going beyond the movie through the medium.
Tricia.
I agree with a lot of what Shane said. I think it's pacing. And for example, like the prequels, I feel like in the movies, Anakin's conversion to Vader happens really quickly. It's how it feels. And then when you watch the Clone Wars animated series and it takes place over years, and it literally is years of your life that you're having to watch season to season, you get a sense of like how long the war actually was going on. So I think there's a place for both movies and television as long as they're used appropriately. And one of the things about Star Wars is that there's so many like details and things, and there's the books and the comic books and the video games. I mean, in using The Mandalorian as an example, they pull from all of that. And if you are, you know, a deep dive Star Wars fan, you pick up on these references. And so I think that having both the movies and the TV shows allows you to, you know, get to the mass media of people, but then also provide avenues for the hard Star Wars fans to be able to see the details and get more on backstories.
James?
I think the biggest struggle for me is when I think about the difference between film and TV, I think about production quality typically, and they have just ramped up so much in how good The Mandalorian looks and what they're doing for the rest of them that it's stuff I would expect out of a movie, but they're proving they can do it in a TV series. So that leads me to believe that TV series are going to typically be more successful. And I think one of the trends being made here is the character development and introduction. Outside of episode 4, like you haven't really had to introduce characters again until episode 7 when we had to get into the new generation. Because even when we back to the prequels, we knew Yoda, we knew Obi-Wan, we knew the story of Anakin Skywalker. Like we had expectations, we didn't have to meet and greet people. And now we get shows like The Mandalorian where we get time to find out about the character and then we can get the attachment. So I'd love to see it, like if things can start in these like mini series and then maybe transition into a bigger film picture.
So you're saying Baby Yoda on the big screen?
Yeah. Let's see Grogu looking good.
Liberty.
Yeah, I've gotten some time to think about episode 8, and I think as it relates to this question of TV series versus big screen movie epic story, I would agree with what Freya said, that you can definitely have those storylines in both, but I think you have to be strategic about the timing in which you do it. And to echo pretty much what everyone said too, I think that when I'm watching a movie, especially from this universe, you know, I didn't watch the new trilogy movies when they came out in theater. I did the marathon these past 2 years and I waited again for that last film. And I remember having so many questions from episode 8 and just feeling very confused and just having a lot of these gaps. And so then when the last episode came out from the new trilogy, when the final one came out, I felt a sense of relief. And I would agree that it was because of all of this epic story being condensed into that one film in 8 that I felt like there were things that were missing. And I was expecting a different sort of journey for those characters and Rey. However, with the newest shows, especially with The Mandalorian that recently came out and the success of that show, I think that there is time to invest in the characters and see their arc kind of in continuation with all of the supplemental features of this universe from Star Wars canon. And I love seeing that trickle into the TV shows. And so I think that there's a lot of opportunity, and I think the future is really bright for, you know, for the Star Wars universe. And I think that if there's going to be a great formula to doing movie versus television. It just depends on the strategy and the storytelling, and the writing has to be in the right place.
And I think going back to, I think what Tricia was saying, which is, was it Tricia? It might've been Freya, that they just need to stick to, you know, what they're going to do and not be afraid to, you know, or maybe it was Erik. We've talked so much already and I feel like it's all jumbled in my head. So I apologize, but sticking with, we have a vision and not switching it halfway through because we get scared or cold feet or whatever. Just if you have an idea for a movie and you think it's going to be good and you green light it, then let it do its thing. Let your creative people, your directors, your writers, stuff, make that vision happen instead of getting involved. So
I think as we talk about like how to present this, so regulars of the podcast will probably know I've been trying to go through Star Wars canon in chronological order. And my favorite pieces that I've come across have been the comics. I've never been a comic reader before, but they do such a nice job, like concisely telling these little stories and have like really nice artwork through it. So I am glad that they're going to keep trying different things. And as me as a Star Wars person, I need to try to embrace them, especially things that I haven't done before.
I just wanted to talk a little bit more, back to the point about character development in TV shows as opposed to movies. I feel like Rogue One really did character development a lot better than some of the other films. It's definitely better than the sequel trilogy. And I really enjoyed Rogue One. I mean, we're getting a Cassian Andor film or a TV show, right? So yeah. I feel like we really got to connect with the characters. I think that movie has its own issues, but I think that as Rogue One, I feel is a beacon for how if you really plan movies really well, really set them in the canon and really understand what you're making, I think that you can be really successful at it.
One thing that I thought was great about Rogue One, if you're talking about storyline and everything, is that what I appreciated is when you watch a movie, especially one that you know there's going to be multiple parts to, you're generally not going to kill off people. So you don't have that sense of danger, like real danger, right? So Rogue One, they could kill everybody and they did kill a lot of people that were main characters in that movie. So it was refreshing to see that your main character that you've spent 2 hours with falling in love with is gone. Like and you can feel sad about it. This sounds terrible, but I loved K2SO. I was very sad when K2SO died. It sounds like in the Andor thing, which we'll talk about, it sounds like K2SO is going to be there, which is wonderful because I need more of him in my life. But you know, you even had the story at the end where they were on the beach and they had that final moment before, you know, the Death Star wave took them out. So the fact that you could, the fact that Rogue One was able to tell a story where they could kill all of their characters made it refreshing, because generally in a story, you're not going to do that. Yes, there are times where you've done that, right? You had, you know, Han Solo in The Force Awakens, you know, get killed and stuff. So like, it's not unheard of. But it's nice that sometimes it happens. Mandalorian, first season with I have spoken.
Quill.
Oh, Quill.
Quill. Oh. He's dead. So like, you know, the fact that they could, you know, you wouldn't think that these people could die because that's kind of been the trope, but they do. And I think that adds a cool thing to that. So to get to the last thing of the Mandalorian, I just want to say, what's everybody, quick opinion, how does everybody feel about what they did with Luke's face? James, we'll start with you.
I don't have a problem with CGI. I thought Grand Moff Tarkin was fine. I thought Leia was fine. I think this is fine.
Liberty?
I agree with James. I don't have... It was a second take for me. I thought he was beautiful. I immediately teared up. I was bawling the entire time. But I had issues with the voice. I think... I'm not sure what they did there. I think they tried their best. It wasn't, you know, Luke's voice for me. But...
You mean Mark Hamill in his late age doesn't sound like Mark Hamill in his like 20 something age?
Of course not. No. Did you have that?
No, now he's the Joker. But I mean, it was cool. I thought there were some technical issues, like either some clipping issues or like the mouth was a little bit off. But like, I just, I saw like two of those and that just kind of threw me off. But it's part of the story. Like, yeah, whatever. Like, I obviously know it's not him. So.
What do you think, Tricia?
I thought he didn't emote well. I felt like his mouth barely moved and he had like just very flat, which maybe because it's been a few years now that he's been a Jedi master, that's like, you just don't show emotion. But part of me wonders if because of how they had to do his face, they just didn't want to risk it looking really weird. So they're like, we're just not going to have a lot of facial features moving so that it looks as best as it can for a human.
Erik?
Yeah, they definitely kind of treaded that line between the ability and the budget to do the CGI and making it a character choice. There were a lot of cutaways whenever he would start speaking or shots from behind him. And I mean, I can get behind Trisha's point that he's being the stoic Jedi master because that's what he thinks he needs to be. Or maybe that's just the way he is right now. And I don't think, I've only watched it once. He didn't introduce himself, did he? Like, he made no attempt to connect with the people in that room. He said, I'm here for the child. Bye.
Yeah, he confirmed he was a Jedi. That was it.
He's that stoic Jedi. He's like, you don't need to know who I am. I'm just here for the child.
Right.
You know, the only thing I want to say about it is I saw in our chat that people were talking about at what point in that sequence did they figure out that that's who it was? And I looked at James the second the X-Wing showed up and I was like, if that's a Jedi, I know exactly who it is.
Oh, yeah, and absolutely.
People were saying that they shouldn't have had him show up in an X-Wing. And then it would have been more of like a shock sequence when that was kind of revealed. But I don't know. They started doing that. They were showing stuff through the camera. And then the second his green lightsabers, I was like, yep, it's confirmed that is yep. definitely who I think it is. Because I thought maybe some other Jedi might be in an X-Wing. Maybe, but... And then I saw the belt.
There's a few hints. But one, obviously, the X-Wing. I was like, okay, you know, the green lightsaber is number two. Three was the black robes. And then the glove. When he put the glove out and because his hand cut off, he wears the glove. I was like, he actually knows
it. Yeah.
I noticed his belt, of all things. Because I was like, oh, that's Luke's belt from the... Return of the Jedi. And so I don't know. I thought he did really well in that scene. I wish that it would have seemed like a little bit more of an effort was made on his part. It seemed like for as dangerous as everything seemed like it was supposed to be, it seemed like he was making very short work of it. And we've seen in the prequels when there was Obi-Wan when there's Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon and there was the droid Eccas and stuff, there was that whole sequence where they're like, oh, we can't fight this. And so even the Jedi's have limits. And I felt like that kind of got away from that. But anyway, enough talk about that. Let's move on to the show since
can I add something?
Yeah, of course.
To the episode I did not see. So just in terms of the question about like faces and like the digital faces, I think that they're okay, but they're not the best. But I wish that the Star Wars universe would be okay with recasting these characters because eventually I think that we're gonna have to get away from just how they look and just recast them. It's fine. Like we can do the mental acrobatics that we need to know that that's the person we know. So I hope that eventually we can just do that. Just recast them. Then we don't have to deal with the digitized face.
I have a quick point to add on to that.
Yeah.
I feel like with a lot of the stuff that they announced, they're setting themselves up really well, because if you think about all of the people we've lost over the last year alone versus, you know, in the last few years from the original trilogy, there's not a lot of time left for them. So I think that the fact that they're bringing in younger people and they're expanding the story of Star Wars is helping set up the ability for Star Wars to continue. And, you know, they're almost taking a page from Marvel. And so I think it's going to make it easier to not have to, you know, use digital faces and things like that, because you're bringing in a wider group of people, more characters. And I think that's going to be helpful moving forward.
You know, it could have just been Ezra and then they wouldn't have even had to do a facial thing. It could have been some totally other Jedi that came out of the woodwork. It could, you know, I told James, I said, it's definitely not Ahsoka because she said, I'm not doing it. But, you know, there are other Jedis around. And force sensitive people that it could have been. One thing I did want to say, I did turn to James when we watched it and I said, Do you think that's CGI, or do you think they found somebody who looks almost like him and then did a little bit of digital stuff on top of him? Because there was a couple shots where something was just a little off, and I didn't think it was a digital thing. I thought it was that they picked somebody, because, you know, there's people that look like people. I thought that maybe they might have picked someone who looked almost like Mark Hamill, a young Mark Hamill.
Maybe we'll find out in the making of The Mandalorian.
I am very excited.
Because of that.
I hope that they talk about their decision to make it Luke and all that stuff. So, well, The Mandalorian, as we keep talking about, is bringing a whole new level of excitement to the franchise, as we all have been displaying for this last hour. Wrapping up earlier this month, season two, and that was definitely something like we've been talking about. We'll see where that goes in season three, likely next year. But we're also getting some other series taking place at the same time. So the first one we're going to talk about is the Ahsoka series. So how do we feel about Ahsoka in The Mandalorian? And then are we excited about an Ahsoka series? Tricia?
I have mixed feelings. Ahsoka is my favorite character in Star Wars. I met Ashley Eckstein, the voice of Ahsoka, and to not have her be part of it was a little heartbreaking. I thought that Rosario did a very nice job. I thought that they did a really nice job with, you know, her makeup and her costuming. I think in terms of where this goes, if I don't see people from Rebels, I'm not going to be happy with the series.
Who are you hoping to see from the from Rebels?
Ezra and Thrawn.
Yeah, I'm with you. I'm with you. I'm excited for that. Freya.
I really like what they've done with Ahsoka, and I feel like Rosario Dawson does a really good job. I can see why people have like an issue with it, and they want the original person that played it. But I think that Rosario Dawson is doing pretty good.
Well, one of the things you have to remember too is Ashley Eckstein did the voice of Ahsoka when she was younger, so it kind of makes sense to have somebody who's going to sound more adult, I guess.
She definitely does look a lot more adult, and she's been through a lot. So she needs to look different. So I'm actually glad that they did that. I mean, it kind of goes to my point of like not being afraid to recast people. So I think that I'm fine with it. I really loved her when she came out, as soon as she came out right away, right off the bat. I'm glad we didn't have to wait till like the end of the episode.
Oh yeah.
I just think that she looked so cool.
With somebody who is, there is so much artificialness to the costume. You could recast her, I think, and it wouldn't be terrible, because she's wears so much makeup and stuff that you could put a number of different actors in there, and I don't think people would have a fit. Erik?
Yeah, not a whole lot else to say. I also want it to be a Rebels show. I just want more Rebels. And they've got such a good opportunity, because I think she definitely did a good job of embodying the role of showing off a little bit of the adult version of Ahsoka with some of that humor. Maybe we only got a small taste of her character in this one episode, but there were some comments that reminded you of the, you know, the snips we saw grow up over the course of Clone Wars.
Liberty.
I am in the middle seasons of Clone Wars right now. So I am like Ashley Eckstein and her version, and just her portrayal is she's courting me right now. So when I watched the live action version and saw Rosario Dawson's portrayal, I love that too. I think I'm able to kind of put both like in different places, but I'm more excited to know that Favreau and Filoni are also, you know, essentially carrying this new series as well. They're executive producing it. And I'm really excited that Filoni is going to be able to just go into several directions with this. But I hope that it ends up being in the same, I mean, vein, obviously, as his cartoon series or his Clone Wars series. I think that I'm all for recasting it. Her voice is something that I'm getting used to as I am kind of getting knee deep into the Clone Wars series. But seeing Dawson take it in the live action debut, like seeing her take it in this more like stoic, like serious direction. And to Freya's point that, you know, she's at this point, she's been through a lot and she's sort of carrying different types of burdens on and along her Jedi journey. I think that I'm excited to see what else she takes on in her own show.
Shane?
I think it was awesome just seeing such a fan favorite character. I know she's one of the biggest characters and favorites there is in the Star Wars universe. So seeing her in live action was really exciting, I assume, for a lot of people, as well as us. I don't really have any problem with the actress or thing as well. I thought she's a great actress. So I think, and her being older and just kind of knowing that, like, what year this is and where it falls in the story plays it that well. The only problem I had with it is it felt like a giant, like an 80s, 90s cartoon where it was essentially just a toy ad, like show up once and then it's like, and now we got a new series. I felt like I wish she had, would have came back in either the last episode or some more involvement than just that. So whether she crashes, like Mando appears in her show or something, or Grogu, I just felt that it's not just a one and done.
I thought maybe she would show up to help with the whole situation that was happening at the end of the episode there, but we got a totally different thing. James?
This is probably the announcement I'm most excited for, just because I think Ahsoka is such a fascinating character being well-developed in both Clone Wars and Rebels. And I really enjoyed how Rosario Dawson portrayed Ahsoka. Like watching her made me think that they were already filming Ahsoka because of how well I think she had a lot of the... I guess what I call ticks or features that Ahsoka would typically do. It felt like she was doing a really good job already recreating the digital character in live action. I think that the piece that I'm excited from Rebels potentially would be Sabine being included, because I think that gives you the Mandalorian tie, which could come back in with Bo-Katan and the Mandalorian of a fight over reclaiming Mandalore and the Darksaber, because she already has the history with it. So, and of course I'd love to see Zeb and Chopper, because Chopper is just hilarious. We love droids. Star Wars droids are like the best, right?
Absolutely. You know, I was actually surprised when they announced all these different shows that they didn't announce a Rebels, like a new Rebels series, because it seems like people really enjoyed Rebels. So that was interesting.
I wonder if this is going to take the place of that. They'll do a live action version instead.
Yeah, I mean, you could throw a lot of things in there, because it does seem like with Thrawn, especially, that they're kind of bridging that gap between the two. Of course, Ahsoka, you know, showed up a lot. There was a bunch of new stuff with Ahsoka in Rebels, where she went to remind me, what was the name of the like spatial place that she was at that was like pure force or whatever it was? It was like, it looked like she was in space, but she was like on platforms and there was like gateways. What was that?
The world between worlds.
That's probably what it was. Yeah.
Okay.
Since we're talking so much about The Mandalorian, I'm just going to come back to the next thing that was on our list. But I'm going to say that the end of season two of Mandalorian, Boba Fett got some more screen time. And then, of course, there was, for those of you who did not stay to the end of the credits, you should definitely go back and stay to the end of the credits, which I feel was kind of poorly done in a way, because every end of the episode has concept art. And this one did not have any concept art. So I almost stopped it. And I would have if people in the chat didn't say stay to the end. So I wonder how many people missed it on their first go through until they saw everything on the internet. Shane, I see you raising your hand. And Liberty, you guys missed it the first time. Tricia, how did you not miss it? You're like up at 4 a.m. watching it right away. Do you always just wait to the end of the credits?
I look to see how much time is left on the episode. And then I'll like start to scan to the end. And I was scanning through the credits and then I saw stuff come up and I was like, wait a minute, backtrack this. So that's how I noticed it.
Yeah. Cause you in our chat, I think you're the first one every week that in the community sees the episode, because you are up and like, you probably have it queued up the night before. You just wake up and hit play.
Sorry.
No, I love it, because I love the fact that you have watched it. Usually you'll put a comment in the Star Wars channel. So as soon as I'm done watching it with James, because we usually watch it as soon as we get up in the morning, I like to go see what your thoughts are. And it's nice that there's somebody already who's watched it. So you're not just like waiting for others to come in and start talking about things, because it's almost every episode, there's something exciting that happens.
I try to not spoil it for people. I try to keep it vague, or I use spoilers when we do chat about it, because I don't want to give that away for people. Like, I enjoy experiencing it for the first time, and I want to make sure that everyone else gets that joy too.
Well, that's why you wake up and watch it like as soon as it's released, because then you have no opportunity of a spoiler. So what do you think this book of Boba Fett's going to be?
Well, I'm a little concerned because they said Christmas 2021, and I think that that's actually going to happen. Why, even with COVID in the world, it's really easy to throw that last like shot on a screen together. So I have a feeling that this is going to happen. But in the Investors Day, Kathleen Kenny specifically made a statement about, it's almost in passing, that the third season of The Mandalorian is also coming out at Christmas 2021. And I'm like, Is this replacing the third season? Are these going to be happening at the same time? So I don't know what we're going to expect. Is it going to be a series? Is it going to be a one-off, made from TV movie? Like, I don't know. I'm intrigued, but I also don't want to replace the actual third season of The Mandalorian that we're expecting.
Yeah. James?
I see like book of something, and I instantly think like Avatar The Last Airbender, where they had books of like 18 or 20 episodes. So they kind of told like a mini series story, basically. And so that's my hope. I don't think it's going to be Mando season 3. Since, he's not technically a Mandalorian, it just kind of loses it. I don't think you want to disappear from the characters, but I'm mostly just confused. Him leading a crime syndicate, I don't feel like it fits with his character or what his goal is with coming back to Jabba's palace. So I'm very curious where that goes. But I am optimistic this can bring some more fan favorite bounty hunters back to the screen, like Boba Fett barely having any time in the original series, and people absolutely adore him for whatever reason. And then you look at the other bounty hunters and people are like, I love IG-88. I'm like, you love the robot that stood there? But, you get the little experiences elsewhere with
Come on, Dengar, James. You like Dengar.
Yeah, you'll go and take a dirt nap. I'm with little information on this one. Like, I'm not a huge Boba Fett fan by any means. Like, I think he was really well represented in Mandalorian, but I'm like, you got to tell me more for me to get fully pumped about this.
What was the guy's name? The blue guy that was in Jabba's palace, that his like translator, not his translator,
Bib Fortuna.
Like, Bib Fortuna. Was anybody else surprised that it looked like Bib Fortuna had basically just been like, I guess I'm in charge now?
That was interesting. I thought that was great. I don't know that he has the savvy to pull off being Jabba, but we don't know how well he's doing.
Well, it was just so weird because I'm like, okay, we're back at Jabba's palace. We've got Jabba's giant throne platform that apparently now has a seat. And then I thought Boba was going to go into the Rancor pit, because I'm like, you're standing on the grate. But, he released the slave, I mean, there's a lot going on in that very short sequence. So, Erik, what do you think of the Boba Fett, Book of Boba Fett?
I've been having that same debate. Do I want it to be season 3 of Mando? Because what's Mando without little Grogu? How is...
Well, that's a whole nother question.
Oh, right. It's interesting to imagine how we've seen Mando progress so much as a character, to the point that, I mean... The two other time until this last episode, the two times we've seen him take off that helmet, he looks absolutely terrifying. And he had a different facial expression in the last episode here. But I think I'd like to see him see us explore the universe with him a little bit more, where he's got his crew again and he doesn't. There's that really interesting twist where now he could potentially lead a planet that he doesn't care about all that much. He doesn't seem to care about those Mandalorian traditions. So there's, definitely we could have, that's a normal Mandalorian season 3. I see the way that could go, but this little thing off to the side with Boba, all I can say is I want to see more Cobb Vanth, and there's a lot of potential for Timothy Oliphant and Boba to duke it out on the planet, because Cobb's been holding down the fort as the sheriff. What the heck's been going on at Jabba's palace? I don't know. I want to find out.
Shane.
I have an agreement with James. Like, I don't get why he's such a huge character when he didn't really do anything in the first, the fall into the red carpet. So, like, I know he looks cool and, like, he has cool weapons, but I'm personally not excited for it. Even my dad texted us last night. He's like, oh, it's going to be season 3 of Mando, which I don't think would happen. I think they're just, like, ranking them, like, well, like, yeah, we're starting to film again, but let's give it a year out. We're just going to dump a bunch of stuff on to make up for 2020 for you. yeah, I'm not personally that excited about it. I think it'll be chapterized, since it's called the book, like chapter 1, chapter 2, and just be a little bit. Maybe it's like a heist movie. Maybe it's like American Treasure, Hidden Treasure. He knows there's a secret in that palace, and that's why he came back. Something unexpected like that. Mm-hmm. And in terms of like Mando season 3, I'm not as worried about it as much as them not being reunited. I give it 1 or 2 episodes of him being depressed looking at pictures of Baby Yoda, and then they'll be back together somehow in some circumstance.
He's just lifting up his helmet, wiping away the tears.
Yeah, like, we have like 1 or 2 episodes of that, and then he's like, you know what, I'm going to go visit him. Or like, something happens. We're like, train me to, or like, I got a lightsaber now too, whatever.
You know, I just kind of wonder, though, if... I mean, I don't know, obviously none of us know, but I wonder, was Grogu meant to be as important throughout the entire Mandalorian series as it's kind of become? Because people love him, right? I'm just wondering if like Grogu was needed to push Jin to be a better person, and now he can go off and be the best Mandalorian he can be or whatever. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that Grogu's time on this is done. And now it can be something else or whatever. So I'm just kind of curious. Liberty, since you're unmuted, what do you?
So based on what you just said, I think there'd be people would have an outrage with that. I think if anything, even if that was the original intention, I related to Breaking Bad, where Jesse was supposed to be killed in season 1, and then people like saw the chemistry between the two characters, and became one of the main characters of the show, if not the main character.
They should just make an animated series or maybe a live action series with Grogu. It's a kid's show and it could be him like learning the Force, and it could be all cute and it could just be like the Grogu show. Yeah. You know, let's learn to count with Grogu.
If that was the ribbon on the thing, like in terms of the Mandalorian, I feel like they would have to continue it somewhere, whether it's just a cartoon, whether it's a comic, something like, people would be like, well, why now? And I don't think they'd ever be satisfied.
Yeah, I guess you don't want your sidekick character of Grogu to be what the Mandalorian, you know, it's not called Grogu or the child, it's called the Mandalorian. So, Liberty, what do you think about the Book of Boba Fett?
For the Book of Boba Fett, I think because we weren't given like what specified like format will this be in? I think, is it going to be the show? Is it going to be the... like what's the tie, you know, to Mandalorian? I'm interested to see how he will tackle the criminal underworld with Fennec at his side too. That's her name, right? Fennec. And so I'm just interested to see, you know, what they get into. I think because of how great and just successful the last 2 seasons were of Mandalorian, I think that they can take it there and we could reinvest in, you know, in this character and his arc, and we could really learn to love, you know, Boba Fett again and see the significance in the Star Wars universe and what he sort of stands for. And I think that they'll take those liberties, you know, when they have to with the show. It's just, again, it goes back to just like these like teasers. It's really hard without much information in what format it's going to be in. Like, it's really hard to say what exactly I'm going to be looking forward to. But I trust Filoni and Favreau that, you know, they have a good storyline there.
I hope so, too. Freya, do you have anything to say? I know you haven't seen it yet, but...
No, but I was really shocked at how much I loved Boba Fett, because I didn't really care about him. I was one of those that was like, why does he get so much attention? He's in the original trilogy for like 2 seconds. But I was really happy to see him. And I think he he's really good. Like what they've done with him is really good. So I'm here for it.
Maybe all the fans like him because he's the only good thing to come out of the Star Wars holiday special, because that's where he first showed up. I mean, that's like the only redeeming quality of the Star Wars holiday special, that and what, Life Day, that people seem to be going on now. So the next announced thing was Rangers of the New Republic. So we don't know too much about this, but Favreau and Filoni are developing it. So more good news there, James. What do you have to say about this one?
So the one like really core detail out of this that has me excited is, as this is happening in the same time frame as Mandalorian and Ahsoka, they talked about this show is going to build up to a culminating moment where there's going to be a crossover between all of them.
Ooh.
So these there will be paths crossed again between Ahsoka and Din and all the characters. And so whatever that is, like I think it's going to be worth getting to that point. I just hope it's not too much of Dave Filoni as a pilot.
You know, that was great though for him to show up in the first season, like as one of those pilots. Like that was pretty dang cool. Weren't they? And this was one of the characters that might be in this was the guy who was like doing the interview on in one of the Mando episodes, right? Where he was interviewed, where he came to talk to. I'm terrible with names. What's her name?
Cara Dune.
Cara Dune. He came to like talk to her. Like he's supposed to be in this, right? Maybe.
Yeah, I saw some marketing online about with that person. Yeah.
I think awesome. His name is Paul Sun-Hyun Lee. Is that right? Is that who we're talking about?
Yeah.
I'd like to see Cara Dune in it. I mean, I don't know what the word ranger means. So she was given that medallion and is now part of New Republic. So there was rumors that there could be possibly a spinoff show for her, and maybe this is how she gets her character gets used a little bit more. We still don't know a ton about her coming from Alderaan, except that she was pretty upset with that guy in the last episode. So it'd be nice to maybe get to know a little bit more about her and about what she did as a drop trooper.
Well, you know, Tricia, if somebody blew up Earth, I'm sure you'd be very upset about it too, if some guy was being a jerk about it.
We agree. We think if this is an opportunity to see Cara Dune's character and have like just her story and her background kind of interwoven with the events and the, the Imperial remnants in the Outer Rim, like this would be the place for it. Like this would be the home for it. And so I'm a huge fan of hers in The Mandalorian, and I really appreciated her comeback in this Mandalorian season two and her involvement. The scene in the episode where she spoke with that pilot, it makes me think that this was forthcoming, and like this, that was foreshadowing a deeper dive into potentially her story and her involvement in the series.
Maybe they'll pull back and she'll just be kind of this tertiary character that comes in. So it's like, oh, it's a recognizable face, but then here's a bunch of new characters that we're going to focus on.
Erik?
Yeah, that's a good point. There's a lot of potential with a lot of these other characters, these pilots we don't know much about. We saw a lot about the Fringe Empire, but we only got these glimpses of what the New Republic is doing and how they're keeping order around the galaxy. If the Empire really thinks that they're doing a terrible job, I mean, this could just be, you know, we could get a lot more information on this, or it could just be cops in space. And I think either way, I'm interested.
Did you guys, for you guys who are Star Wars fans for a long time, did you guys ever, way back in the 90s, there was, I think it was called Troops, and it was like a fan fiction video of stormtroopers on Tatooine, and it was done in the kind of vein of the cops reality show. You saw that, Erik?
It may have been one of the first videos I ever downloaded on the internet.
I think it was for me too, to be honest, because video wasn't a big thing on the internet back in the late 90s.
No, not at all.
Tricia, I feel like you had to have seen this, no?
I vaguely recall it. I was thinking, like, is this going to be something like a space version of Chips or something like that?
Oh.
My mom used to watch when she was younger, and, you know, just more slapstick humor. I don't know, though. That doesn't seem very, it doesn't really seem like that would be what Filoni and Favreau would do necessarily.
Sure.
Oh, like a Star Wars Troopers version of Starship Troopers.
Yeah. Like that, or I can't remember what the other one was where they had the cops and everything okay, meow. That's all I remember from it. Super Troopers.
Or Super Troopers.
Yeah. Just a Star Wars version of Super Troopers. Like, we're boarding your vessel. Anyway, moving on. All right. So the next few things, there's not a lot of stuff. I mean, there's a couple that are big ones we're going to get to, but we're just going to kind of pop through some of these real quick. So the spinoff of the Clone Wars series focusing on the Bad Batch. Of course, we already got a little bit of this from a couple of episodes of the last season of Clone Wars that came out. So it was the first arc of that season. Takes place, the new show takes place after Order 66. And the speculation is that it's be releasing next year. So what do we think about this? Erik, I'll give you a first crack at this.
Okay. I mean, they've got a trailer out already. That's pretty promising. Bad Batch was one of those little those stories that we heard about when the last season, the original version of the last season, got canceled, that this was one of the stories Filoni talked about. So when it came out, it was great to see that. In some respects, watching the entirety of that last season, it felt almost like a throwaway series. They're interesting characters, but we wanted to get to Ahsoka doing cool things and the wrap up of the Darth Maul storyline and all of that. I think there's a lot of potential because it looks like it's going to take that look at what happens with those clones that were affected by Order 66 and those who might not have been. I don't know exactly what the Bad Batch, you know, how maybe they weren't chipped the same way as the others. Oh. I guess we'll find out. But there's a lot of interesting material there, and they were interesting characters because they were so different, but they had to work together to be a useful unit. I think there's a lot of good potential there, and the animation looks like the same Clone Wars animation we're used to. So I know people who like the Clone Wars are going to like a look back at that style too.
I will say that one thing that the Bad Batch did was I feel like it was a very good way to show that people of different abilities or different disabilities, depending on how you look at it, can come together and still be very successful working together, as opposed to, I mean, they're called the Bad Batch. You know, they don't fit in with everybody else, but them working together shows that, you know, you can be successful, you know, even more successful than, you know, normal people or whatever together, which I think is great. Freya, what do you have to say about Bad Batch?
Well, I don't really know too much about them yet. I'm still making my way through Clone Wars and Rebels, but I'm excited either way. Cool.
Shane, what do you think? Have you seen the last end of Clone Wars? I know Freya's making her way through, so I don't know if you'd actually seen it all the way.
No, we're currently making it through Clone Wars. I mean, we know a little bit about them, and I think we recently just rewatched the episode where it kind of touches on their going through the training, which totally reminded me of American Gladiators. Shooting the tennis ball guns at people. I think it's gonna be a real fun show. I think it's really interesting to think about just like their chemistry together. And I'm really curious to see where they ended up after Order 66 and what are they doing and what have they been doing during time. That's what I'm most excited about.
Well, I mean, again, not to bring up the Mandalorian again, but in the last episode of the Mandalorian, they talked about how like that Boba basically was a, you know, a clone. He's like, oh, you're a clone and blah, blah, even though, you know, so yeah, it'll be interesting. I always, you know, it'll be interesting to see how that goes. And I'm also interested to see how it transitions from clone troopers to like regular people and stormtrooper, because they're not clones when we see them in A New Hope. So it'll be interesting to see that brought to life. Tricia, what do you got?
Well, nobody's mentioned that Fennec Shand was in the sizzler reel. So I'm excited to see what they do to develop her story before The Mandalorian. And there's a couple of clone troopers in Rebels. They're older. Rex was one of them. He's probably my favorite clone trooper, but he had a couple of, you know, buddies with him. And do we meet them when they're younger in this series? Oh. You know, like I'm just curious, like, what do you do once you're a retired clone trooper? And are they going to talk about that a little bit in this series?
Now, I mean, are you one of the people that subscribe to the fact that Rex was on Endor with everybody in Return of the Jedi?
I mean, I've heard it and I've seen like the footage and yeah, it does kind of look like it could be him, but I feel like that was not intentional.
Sure.
So I don't know if I buy that.
I don't know. I like the idea that maybe he could be there or whatever, but I enjoyed Rex. I enjoyed watching Rex throughout the Clone Wars. And then I enjoyed watching him coming back for Rebels and stuff. James, Bad Batch.
Oh, well, I'll go back to the point that Erik was making. I was so angry that it took up a third of that final Clone Wars season. Right. Because I'm like, this isn't what I signed up for. Like, yay, we get to find out what happened to Echo and all that good stuff. And yes, they are a very compelling group of clones. It's an interesting kind of concept, but like, we already kind of had that between Rex and Echo and Fives. I'll look forward to it because I think the Clone Wars did really good at storytelling, and Bad Batch can do the same, especially like you talked about post Order 66 and what life was like. But still angry at them.
Star Wars Visions is going to be a 10 episode miniseries featuring animated shorts directed by Japanese anime creators. That's kind of cool because Erik, you were just talking about the visual style of the Clone Wars. So it'll be cool to have kind of an anime, sort of visual. We kind of got, am I wrong in remembering that we kind of got something similar to that with Star Wars Resistance? Because that was kind of supposed to be like an anime-ish kind of style, wasn't it originally?
I think so. I really, that's the one Star Wars thing I have like watched nothing of so far.
I mean,
it started to get really good.
It was absolutely a different animation style than what we looked at like. And I think that's what turned off so many people to the series, is they just couldn't get over how it looked, on top of the plot being a little more childish than the other ones. So we'll see. I am excited for this. I enjoyed the animation style and the difference. But if the Star Wars fandom is ready to embrace something different.
Well, I don't think that Resistance was very anime like. So I'm really excited about this because I really love anime. So I'm excited to see what they do with it. And I think that it will be more adult, because since anime kind of can go childish or adult.
Star Wars, they're just trying to fold everybody's likes into one universe. Liberty, Shane, what do you guys think about Star Wars Visions? I mean, not much to go off other than it's going to be animated shorts.
We're huge samurai fans, and we've seen a little bit of that in the anime that we have watched. I don't have like extensive knowledge in it, but I think I'm here for it. I'm excited to see what direction they'll take it in. And I'm sure within the Star Wars fan base, there's subgroups. So I think that they're excited as well. I'm hoping. I've seen some like just local like concept art from different artists that already blend those two together, and I love that concept art. And what do you think?
Yeah, so I think it is an interesting, unique outtake on it. I've been introducing Liberty to like Studio Ghibli movies and Akira and Ghost in the Shell, some classics. And as she had mentioned about the samurai piece, like, there's already been for quite a few years a lot of like collaborations in like the collectible community where they've taken Darth Vader and Boba Fett, like many of the armored characters, and made them like samurai versions, and they look amazing. So I'm excited to see if they do anything like that. And recently, about 2 years ago, they came out with an anime version of Batman, and it was pretty awesome. So
I got to look that up. That sounds awesome. Tricia, what do you think?
Well, I think they're easing people into it. I am all like media, and so I actually brought some down, but I have the manga of some Star Wars here.
Oh.
So like, they've done books. They did a Claudia Gray, Her Lost Stars, and then Leia, Princess of Alderaan. And then now they're getting into like Rebels. And these are like stories that haven't been told yet.
Oh,
and
cool.
So I'm hoping it's a little bit kind of like Forces of Destiny, where it's these shorter episodes, and we don't get a retelling of what we already know, but it's like some filler about a character, and it's just kind of nice to see like a little bit extra. So I'm really excited about it because I like anime, I love manga, so they kind of go hand in hand, and I'm really interested to I think it'll be really cool too to represent a different type of style and kind of a culture that goes with that, because a lot of it is, you know, very Americanized. So I'm glad that they're choosing to do this. And, you know, samurai films were a huge influence to George Lucas. So I feel like this is only like a logical step forward in expanding the Star Wars universe and the Star Wars, like reaching to more people and more fans.
Yeah, this I like that idea of filling in with short kind of stories. I have not been somebody to sit and read through, you know, the expanded universe like James has been doing. But I actually read the Darth Vader comic recently, which was really great. It was about him, you know, it was a story of how he got his red lightsaber. And that was really interesting to me because I didn't even think about that. It literally starts as soon as he kind of gets off the and no, literally starts there and goes to getting his lightsaber. And you meet a couple of Jedi along the way. You know, after post Order 66. So very interesting. So hopefully they can do stuff like that with the different like little mini stories, because you could really fill in a lot of gaps and questions that people have. One of the faces of Rogue One, a Star Wars story, is coming back for Andor, which will tell the story of Cassian Andor and his trusty droid K2SO. I'm very excited for this. We'll see Cassian's story and what brought him to join the rebellion. Freya, we'll start with you.
I'm excited.
Oh, okay, go on.
I am excited, but I mean, it's not the thing that I'm like the most excited for, but sure. I will watch it.
Bring a K2SO. I'm there. Liberty.
Yeah, me too. I mean, to date, Rogue One is one of my favorite films within that universe. So I think I am definitely looking forward to seeing Cassian again. Just from the trailer, I think I'm really excited about the just the work that they're doing behind the scenes. One of the main, you know, because he's the main character, I think that we're going to see even more. This is like in true Star Wars fashion, where they're sort of rehashing that story and they're bringing these fan favorite, you know, characters back to the screen and just expanding upon that, just their environment and their storyline. So I'm looking forward to them shedding more light on the, you know, the troubled past and really, you know, just new situations that they're dealing with on Andor.
Shane?
For me personally, I think this is the one I'm least excited about. I was a huge fan of Rogue One. It's probably my favorite Star Wars film. I know how it's going to end. So, like, I'm not as invested in the backstory of the character. That
was for one. But you knew how Rogue One was going to end. You knew that the plans were going to get to the whatever, but you still really enjoyed it. So maybe.
I know. So, yeah. So maybe I'll be in for a surprise, because that's true. With Rogue One specifically, like, we know how it ended, but I think that's why it also worked for me, is because I maybe wasn't as like going in as invested. So I was really surprised and just enjoyed the movie, enjoyed the ride. As of right now, least excited about this one. Maybe I'll be pleasantly surprised.
James.
So there's two pieces I'm excited about this. One is actually getting some backstory behind Cassian, because I feel like I barely got to know him in Rogue One. Like, he just stayed too mysterious. And so I want to give him a chance to embrace him a little bit more and then further my love of Rogue One, hopefully. The other thing is, this is where we'll start talking more about kind of that genre splitting out. So instead of Star Wars living in that like sci-fi fantasy world, you know, we saw the Western style with Mandalorian work. And so this is going to be a spy thriller, which always makes me think like James Bond. And I'm like, James Bond and Star Wars could be fascinating concept. I'm excited for all the like the subterfuge and everything that could bring to show a different side of Star Wars.
Erik,
all of that, pretty much. This has potential to be really dark. So I'm hoping K2SO draws us back from that, because I really like K2SO. Cassian made it clear in Rogue One, he has seen things and done things for the rebellion that he's not proud of. And we're probably going to see some of that throughout this. So hopefully it's not as dire as it could be.
I just hope they make sure that Alan Tudyk comes back to voice him, because I think
he has to. Yeah.
Yeah. Tricia.
Well, hopefully this will help. But when I was at Star Wars Celebration in Chicago, I was in the Alan Tudyk panel, and he did say he was coming back.
Yeah.
So in addition to that, they talked about 200 characters that, you know, that they were saying will be cast for this. You know, they mentioned like Genevieve O'Reilly, who played Mon Mothma. I'm curious to see if they can get Forrest Whitaker to come back to play Saw Gerrera, like as a younger, less mechanical version of himself. And I'm also curious because he said he's been in this, you know, this fight for most of his life. Where is this going to take place in his life? Are we going to see flashbacks like they do in The Mandalorian? Is it going to start when he's a kid? You know, I mean, I know we know the ending, but I am kind of intrigued to see what they do with the characters.
I worry when you say 200 named characters, like since it's a one season show, like I worry it's going to be too much and that we're just not going to be able to embrace all of it.
Maybe we'll get more than 8 episodes a season like The Mandalorian, though.
I heard that it was 12 episodes that will be an hour long each. That's like the scuttlebutt.
I hope that that's the case, because that was my biggest disappointment with Mandalorian episodes was the fact that some of them were, especially like in season one, I think there were a couple that were just over 30 minutes long and I just wanted more. I mean, that's one thing that was nice about broadcast television is you knew you had to fill, you know, 42 minutes or whatever every week. However, it was nice that when they did want to go over time, they were able to. So it's a kind of double-edged sword. So 10 years after Revenge of the Sith, this one I'm very excited about. 10 years after Revenge of the Sith, we'll revisit two of the core characters from the prequels in Star Wars, Obi-Wan Kenobi. Ewan McGregor, I always pronounce his name wrong. I watched on Apple TV Plus, him and one of his friends did this motorcycle tour. They did one where they went around the world. They did one where he went down called Long Way Down, where they went down to through Africa to the tip. And then this new one, they came from the bottom of South America up to LA. Great show. I love Ewan McGregor, so it was nice to see him like as a person and not in a role. And of course, Hayden Christensen is coming back, which I was very shocked to hear about as Obi-Wan and Darth Vader, of course. And that's all we know. So, Erik, I feel like I keep throwing you in the middle. I'm going to throw you out first so you can actually get your thought out there. What do you think about Obi-Wan Kenobi's series?
I am most excited for Obi-Wan. I mean, there's just so much potential here. And seeing Hayden Christensen, I don't know why I'm super pleased. I'm really hoping this is his chance to redeem himself in some way. I think he got a little too much shade in the prequels. Not necessarily his fault that George Lucas sometimes writes like he's, you know, creating a puppet show. I don't know. I don't know what an apt analogy there, but I have no idea where this is going to go. We obviously know where Obi-Wan ends up, but most of this he's potentially could be just on Tatooine protecting young Luke. But if Darth Vader is involved, I don't know what's going to happen. This is going to be great. It'll fill in that gap that some people have said they don't care about between the end of the movies and when we, you know, meet him as an old man, but just that glimpse of him on Tatooine when he fought Darth Maul, that was amazing. And I want more Obi-Wan in as an older Obi-Wan.
I mean, Obi-Wan's going to be amazing. Although you were talking about him being possibly like a small, you know, young Luke Skywalker. And I'm just thinking, mm-hmm. So are they going to digitally make Mark Hamill young again and put it on some like little child, you know,
10-year-old Mark Hamill face.
Freya, what do you think about Obi-Wan Kenobi?
I'm really excited about Obi-Wan Kenobi. I don't know if anyone ever saw the fan trailer that was made for like a Kenobi fan trailer, and that really hyped me up for it. So I'm super, super excited. I'm super excited to see Hayden Christensen come back. Like, I didn't hate him. I actually really loved him. So I hope he
he's a good
really
actor.
Gets to shine.
He got a raw rap because of terrible writing.
And I think that like George Lucas just didn't know how to direct him. So
yeah, that too. James.
I just have two questions that I want answered. And that is, will we get to see Qui-Gon Jinn as a Force ghost teaching Obi-Wan how to become a Force ghost? Ooh. And why would Obi-Wan leave Tatooine when his only purpose is to watch Luke? So if he's going to have a confrontation with Vader, it's not going to be on Tatooine. So why would he leave? What could be more compelling than protecting the last hope?
Ooh. Yeah. I just wanted to like add on to that. I hope he remembers. I hope we find out why he forgot R2-D2. Like, did he get hit in the head really bad or something that he doesn't remember that he ever had a droid?
It's called old age.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm glad that question was answered right away.
He's only like 50 years old in this at that time, if even.
What are you talking about? I'm talking about like he had gray hair. He was like at least he looked like he was in his like 70s. But I guess if you're doing time frame wise, he probably wasn't that old.
Not that old.
I don't know. I'm not even 40 yet. And I forget stuff all the time. Anyway, Liberty.
Well, you know, Kennedy says this is going to be the rematch of the century. So I'm looking forward to that. I agree. Looking forward to some redeeming qualities coming through in this series. And I'm a huge fan of Kenobi. I think this is going to be the opportunity to expand further on their relationship and that dynamic, you know, absent of Qui-Gon Jinn being that initial father figure for Anakin. I think it was really hard for Kenobi to take this place. And it was a huge to fill in, you know, those large shoes. I think it's going to be interesting to see how that relationship continues to play out when they do reunite in this series. And also shout out to Deborah Chow, you know, for being the lead director here, since she did an amazing job with some of the Mando episodes. So I'm excited to see her guide this team.
So Tricia, are you excited to see the rematch of the century?
Well, I have some thoughts, you know, because it makes sense. Like, why would Obi-Wan leave Luke? But I'm hoping that they draw on some of the lines from the original trilogy, like Vaderverse senses Obi-Wan. And he's like, I felt a presence that I haven't felt since. And we don't know what that since is. So like, maybe he felt the presence of Obi-Wan on Tatooine and Obi-Wan had to leave Tatooine so as to not bring Vader to Tatooine.
Yeah.
That could possibly be, you know, something.
But you don't want to bring Vader to Tatooine, because then you're like, pay no mind to your son over here.
Yeah. Also, like that when we see Vader and Kenobi battling each other before, you know, in A New Hope, like, you know, he says, I'm the master. And I'm just like, is there more that happened between when he leaves him on Mustafar and that like interaction? And I'm also just curious, Hayden Christensen is not filled out very well for a Vader presence. So I'm just curious how they're going to use him. Is he going to be like in the, you know, flashbacks or something, or he's having memories, and is he going to be like when they take the helmet off and he's doing like some back the tank like treatments? Like, how exactly are they planning on using him? And can we please get James Earl Jones? I want his voice. Like, I
was just going to mention that,
but
too.
we need him back. And he's an older, you know, an older person too. Like, please somebody sit down and record him reading the dictionary so that we can have his voice forever.
They brought him back in Lion King, so why not? Yeah.
The problem is didn't they have him a little bit in Rogue One? And just because he's gotten older, his deep voice doesn't, it's still James Earl Jones, but it doesn't sound Darth Vader-y like it used to. You know what I mean? You know, don't choke on your aspirations or whatever he said. I don't know. Shane.
I think it has potential to be very exciting, just to see what happens to one of the biggest characters in the Star Wars universe. After the big showdown, and what leads up to A New Hope. I really have no expectations, but I think he'd be a lot of fun here. I think he could like play around with like a catch me if you can type thing, or like grumpy old men when they're playing pranks on each other and sending mail to each other and stuff. So I'm just really curious about how they interact throughout these years and the relationship development. And just not knowing that it ended the way we saw it at the end of episode 3.
This next one, I think I'm also very excited for. Fan favorite will finally get his turn in the lead role, which maybe they should have done instead of Solo. Star Wars Lando is bringing the smooth-talking scoundrel front and center for his event series. Shane, we'll start with you. What do you think? You want to see more Lando?
Yeah, I mean, he's an interesting character. I think that the charisma behind him alone will make it entertaining, at least. He has a bunch of stories that we do not know about via the movie. He has a bunch of history, things that he did that were uncovered a little bit in Solo. But I think there's just so much life that this person has lived. So many stories to tell, and I'm here for it.
I want the crossover of him and Edna Mode. No more capes. James.
I stand by my favorite thing I read on the internet about this is whoever decided not to call it the Calrissian Chronicles really screwed up, because that's what I'm hoping this is. Like, I hope it's Billy Dee Williams narrating his old stories, played by Donald Glover, living out all of the stories as he remembers them and tells them. So they're going to be extravagant and blown out, not real, but what he thinks. I just think there could be a lot of fun with it.
Erik,
I'm just going to take James's because now I'm super interested. You had me at Donald Glover, but having Billy Dee on narrating himself, we saw in Solo, he does narrate his adventures. So let's do it.
Billy Dee Williams, I think, has any time that they've needed a Lando thing, he's like, I'm in. Like, I feel like he's one of those people that all you have to do is say, hey, you want to be Lando? And he's like, I'm there. Doesn't matter. Freya, what do you think? Lando?
So I'm not that excited about Lando, or at least I wasn't, but then James hyped me up for it. So now I am excited. If that's what it is, then yes, I will watch it and I will be excited. But if it's just Lando being Lando, I don't like Lando too much.
I'm terrified I have set everyone up for the letdown of the Star Wars group.
I mean, I feel like James needs to be hired for this show, because that is a show I would watch. So
in James's defense, it was something he read online, so it wasn't just out of his mind. So don't write the angry letters or anything to us. It's not James's fault. Liberty.
Yeah, I mean, excited. I think looking forward to seeing the galaxy's favorite scoundrel in action. And I'm a fan of what James said. I'll piggyback on that. And if we can get Billy Dee Williams to narrate, and I can stand by Donald Glover, reprising that role, then I think that would be interesting and exciting to see. It'd be a fun laugh.
I want to know what the room is going to look like that he, like, when he closes the book or opens it at the beginning of an episode. And he's like, is there a fireplace? Is he?
It's going to be like those old Walt Disney things where he, like, walks over and pulls the book off the shelf and opens it up. And I can see that. Maybe yeah. Maybe it's in a redo of the Falcon when it was in its prime, and he just never got over it.
he has a Colt 45 next to his recliner.
There you go.
I'm interested about the director Justin. I think it's Simien. He did the Dear White People, and he apparently is a big Star Wars fan. So again, that kind of ties back to what I said earlier about being passionate. So I have a feeling that this could be a really good event series, whatever that means. And just to kind of layer on top of what James is saying, I would like it if they tie it back to the Rise of Skywalker, and he's telling these stories to Jana while he's helping her find her family.
That could be a thing, because it seemed like they were gonna like hang out and do something together.
I did have one quick question, if anyone picked this up. They presented this at the end of when they had presented all of their animated things. So I had the question of, is this going to be an animated series versus a live action?
Maybe it's Billy Dee doing the voice of Lando and there's no Donald Glover, but it's animated. I don't know.
Having Donald Glover responding to what Billy Dee is saying.
Yeah. I now that I have that vision of him like pulling a book down. This show is ruined for us out of this conversation, because it needs to be this and it has to have that. Anyway, we're almost done with the conversation. We've got two more topics quickly to cover. One will be very quick. Star Wars is building up stories around the High Republic, new novels, comics, and a show called The Acolyte. This is a new take on the franchise, being described as a mystery thriller that somehow involves dark side powers. So, Tricia, we'll start with you, since I feel like we keep leaving you to the end.
I don't know what to think of this, because we don't know anything about the High Republic. And we won't know until January of 2021 when the first book comes out. But, this emerging dark side, are we going to see Darth Plagueis possibly and his apprentice, Darth Sidious? And then I heard rumors that maybe like Benedict Cumberbatch might be cast or something in this. And I love him. And if that were the case, he'd be a great Sith. So, there's a lot of mystery around this mystery series, but I'm really interested to see where it goes.
Until Darth Plagueis starts swirling his hand and it's a time portal. And oh, wait, wrong movie. Freya.
I am super excited about it. I was bummed because I really want more of the Old Republic. And I thought that they were going to go to the Old Republic. But I think that this will be just as good, and I'm really excited to see it. But because there's so many stories from the Old Republic that they could possibly weave in to the High Republic, and just seeing an era with more Jedi, kind of like the prequels, but maybe filmed better and written better, I'm really excited about that.
So, Erik, is this going to be almost like we talked about earlier, like Cops in Space? Is this going to be like CSI investigators because it's a mystery thriller? So is it going to be like Murder on the Orient Express, but in space?
Hey, let's go for it. I just want to know more about this High Republic era, because it, like Freya said, we don't know anything about this, really. This whole new series is coming out. It's a time period we haven't looked at before. So I'll take whatever we can get.
Liberty.
Yeah, I think the tease is enough for me to get excited. It seems like it would be a darker show than what we're used to seeing, you know, from Star Wars series. And so I think because it takes place, or it's set to take place before the start of the film saga, I'm excited to explore and also potentially see some alignment with you know, the film saga and where we're currently at with characters. And I'm all for it if we can dive deeper into the dark side of the Force and, you know, see and hear some explanations. I haven't read too much about it, or I haven't read too much about the High Republic series, so I'm looking forward to learning more.
James.
Yeah, I think Freya made a good point about, I think a lot of Star Wars fans will be upset and hold this to a higher standard because it's not Old Republic material. I think the people that love Jedi Knight Revan want Jedi Knight Revan, and that's all they want. And so the fact that that era is getting skipped again, I think is hard. But to the point of so much unknown, like there is one thing that is known of who exists in this time frame, and we might get a younger version of Yoda existing somewhere in here as well to help anchor some things.
And he's, I think, 900. That
could be interesting. Yeah, so he's like the one name we know that actually could be somewhere in there.
I figured it out. Luke is going to teach Grogu how to go into that like Jedi space where you can do portals through time, and Grogu is Yoda, and everybody will be vindicated because it is baby Yoda. Thank you, folks. I'm done.
Well, this has been Tag's TED Talk.
I'm not sure how I feel about this.
Shade, what are your thoughts on High Republic stuff?
I'm just excited for a different time period, for new stories, new characters. Any possibility of having Sith Lords from the past, or different from the three that we've seen in movies thus far, getting over Dark Sidious. So, yeah, any of those great, like, more behind the Sith and the story behind and what they actually stand for and how it evolves throughout time, I think is exciting. So there's a new content that we haven't seen in the new characters.
Cool. Finally, so we're going from completely new stories to people that are completely familiar. The final one is Star Wars: A Droid Story, which is going to bring back C-3PO and R2-D2 in an animated film as a droid's guide a new hero on an epic journey. So what do we think this is? Or are we excited for this? I mean, C-3PO and R2-D2 have appeared in almost every single thing. Freya.
I've actually been waiting for this for the entire time we've been recording, because so I was so confused when this came out, because I was like, don't we already have something animated with them? And then I realized that the thing I was thinking of was Star Wars Blips. I don't know if you guys have seen that. Mm-mm. The Star Wars Blip shorts are so funny and they're so good. And you have R2-D2 there, and you have BB-8, and they're like 1 minute, 2 minute long. Little like animated shorts, and they're so good and they're so funny. So if it's anything like that, I'm totally in, because that I just randomly fell into Star Wars Blips, and I couldn't stop watching because it was just so good. There's only a few episodes and they're only like 1 minute, so, but that will be like one of the best few minutes in your life.
I will have to go look this up. Erik.
I'm guessing that this could be kind of a kids movie. What, you know, I mean, we're talking about expanding the fan base. My nieces absolutely love everything Star Wars. I think they would love a story like this, but whichever way they go, I'm sure it'll be interesting. And I hope Anthony Daniels gets one more shot at his his role.
I love Anthony Daniels. Is that James?
This is the one I am most nervous for, because of what happened to my minions in Despicable Me. When you take the sidekick and try to make them the main character, it just doesn't seem like it works out as well. So I'm really worried that the comedic duo of C-3PO and R2 will have just too much airtime, and we'll see, you know, who their new hero that they're guiding through and how much they can take the stage away from them.
Shane, C-3PO, R2-D2, what do you think?
I'm definitely on board for an R2-D2. C-3PO is not my cup of tea. I do love the droids, though, whether BBA or BD-1, which I believe is the name from the video game Fallen Order. I mean, the droids are just, they, like, as James has mentioned, they're great sidekicks, so maybe a little nervous about carrying something entirely that isn't just a very short form format kind of content. But I think it'll be enjoyable. So it'll reach the kid audience, it'll sell toys, it'll be great. Definitely worth a watch, really.
We did a Star Wars show that has BB-8 and D.O. and C-3PO and Chopper, and they just could subtitle it. Done. Liberty, what do you think?
For it, I think this is going to be a fun deep dive into their R2-D2 and C-3PO's dynamic and their relationship. And I've watched all of the Star Wars blips shorts as well, Freya. So I think if it's anything, again, like that, in that vein, then it'll be enjoyable. Yeah. For sure. So,
Tricia, I know that in the chat somebody posted a R2 like nightstand table that you might get to make. So are you excited for 3PO and R2-D2 to be in a story together?
I am. And Anthony Daniels did tweet that he was coming back to voice this. So hopefully that's the case. But the thing I'm actually really excited about is that they highlighted that they're doing this with ILM. And ILM was basically has pushed film special effects since, you know, the original trilogy. And so I'm interested to see. I have a feeling it's probably going to be animated, because it sounded like from the tweet that Daniels is doing the voice, but he's not getting it back into the suit. So I'm interested to see, like, what does this animation look like? Is it going to be something completely different from anything we've ever experienced before?
Could be exciting. Well, we have talked for almost after editing and everything, almost 2 hours all about Star Wars. So I want to thank our awesome Roundtable panel for talking about Star Wars. I do have a final question before we wrap up, but I do want to say goodbye to everybody. And then we'll ask one last question, and that'll be the end of it. Thank you, Community Manager Freya, for joining. Thank you, Trivia Master Liberty, and Shane, for joining Liberty to be the Star Wars expert there. Thank you, of course, Producer James, as always, for helping out with this and setting up a lot of the structure for it. Jedi Master Tricia, thank you for joining. And of course, the voice of DLW Weekly and the co-host of the Supreme Resort, which, like I said, I highly recommend people go check out, because I like the concept of that podcast quite a bit. Erik, also feel free to, you know, book your vacation through Concierge, our friends over there. Last question is, after we've done this whole discussion now, what is the thing everybody's most excited for? So Freya, what are you most excited for after our discussion?
I think that it has to be the Ahsoka show, maybe. I think so. Yeah.
Okay. Definitely. Liberty?
I think I'm most excited for Ahsoka. Definitely Ahsoka.
Ahsoka's winning, man. Shane, what are you most excited for?
Whatever Taika's going to do. Because it's unknown, and I believe in him, and he has a good track record.
James?
Add another point to Ahsoka with an honorable mention to Visions.
Even after you came up with that really great Lando thing.
Yeah, but that's my concept. I need them to tell me that's what the concept's going to be, and then my answer changes immediately.
Tricia, what are you most excited for? I know, being as big of a Star Wars fan as you are, you're excited for everything. More Star Wars is better.
You just took my answer. I think I'm just most excited that there's a rejuvenation to Star Wars right now. And this community, you know, like talking to everyone tonight, like I am totally passionate about Star Wars, but I love the fact that there's a lot of different genres and that this could bring a lot of people together. It broke my heart after, you know, we had the last Jedi, and there was such a division amongst fans. And I feel like The Mandalorian has kind of healed that. And I'm hoping that we can just build on that. And I'm just excited to see where, you know, Lucasfilm takes these things moving forward.
Erik.
Well, now my answer is going to be simple and boring compared to Tricia's. I'll take a different tack and just say Mando number 3.
Yeah, I'm going to be such a cop out here. I'm really excited for everything. But I think I'm probably, I like space battles. So I think I'm really excited for Rogue Squadron because I want to see some good. That was one thing I really liked about Rogue One was that it was, you know, 21st century graphics really showing like some awesome space fighting and very much in that vein. And that's one of the reasons I like Star Trek Deep Space Nine. There was a lot of space battles. So the fact that they're working with more stuff, I think it could be really great. So once again, thank you everybody for joining. If you are listening to this and you want more roundtable kind of stuff, or you want to suggest some topics for roundtables, shoot us an email, feedback@dlweekly.net. If you guys want to reach out and talk to anybody who's been on the panel, I would say if you're in the Discord supporter chat, you can talk to all these people. They're all in the chat. If you are not a supporter, become a supporter and get in there. We have all types of cool stuff going on all the time. So,
and please join us on Star Wars Wednesdays too. Like we have so many of these kinds of conversations in the chat.
Yeah, there's a whole Star Wars section of the chat. So if you're a Star Wars fan, that's the place to be. So thank you, everybody. Enjoy going out and watching all your Star Wars dreams, and may the Force be with everybody.
Till the spire.
Ladies and gentlemen, Disneyland has now ended its normal operating day. We hope you've enjoyed your visit to the Magic Kingdom and that you'll be back with us again soon.